I was directed here by the Crystal Tower of Mount Wisdom. Today we speak to one of the greatest economic minds of Earth. I wish to be connected with Richard Wolf of the planet Earth, Lord of Finance and all things economics.
I heard your cry for help. Closer.
Closer. Initialize.
Please ask your questions to Dr. Richard Wolf.
I always hear people talking about Marx. I just wanted to cut to the chase. What is Marx's beef with capitalism exactly?
Coming as he did 50 years after the French Revolution, he was captured, as young people in his time almost always were, by the nobility, if you like, of the French and American revolutions. These slogans, liberty, equality, fraternity, democracy. In his reading, it was the transition out of feudalism into capitalism that made a promise. And the promise was, if you get rid of lords and serfs, which is what feudalism had, and you replace it with capitalism, then you're going to get liberty, equality, fraternity, and democracy. But Marx, for better or worse, comes 50 years later. He lives most of his creative life in London. That's a London described in the novels of Charles Dickens. And as he looks around London, then the epicenter of capitalism's growth and self-confidence, he doesn't see liberty, equality, fraternity, or democracy. He sees a society deeply split between rich and poor. The more the mass of people agitated for things like the right to vote, the more the rich, precisely because they are relatively few, displacing the old gentry, landed, feudal class of earlier England, they were threatened in their wealth by the growing poverty of the mass majority of the people. And so they quickly learned the lesson no capitalist class has ever forgotten. You better control politics because your wealth will be jeopardized.
What you're saying essentially is there was monarchies and feudalism, and then there was these revolutions, and instead of transferring to democracy and equality, it actually got captured and hijacked a little bit during the transition by whoever made money first, and they kind of jimmy-rigged it to call it democracy, but really it was like a new form of nobility, kind of similar to how Russia took communism, but then, you know, made it their own thing, the leaders of Russia.
Absolutely. That's it. That's his argument. His argument is we have to face a reality and then ask a question, which is why did capitalism, and he gave them the credit, you know, the Thomas Jeffersons, the Robespierres, the Dantons, anyone you want to pick, they believed, they were sincere in believing that capitalism would bring with it liberty, equality, fraternity, and democracy. So Marx says you have to face the reality. It didn't happen.
I saw an interview you did on some Fox News, where there's always this kind of the fear of like, people are gonna take my money away or whatever, you know, punish success and all this kind of whatever. Disagree or agree with it. Let's just say, you know, you give the right that and you say, we're not gonna take away anything. Don't you think there could be a system where, don't you think a separation of power and wealth, like having a list of 200 people, but instead of the heads that you're going to chop off, it's people that are not allowed to be part of government, they're not allowed to, control, media things or...
The only way I could imagine something like that happening is if there was a social consensus.
If the workplace was democratized, something which I advocate, worker co-ops were the way we organize business, there's no problem with a worker co-op saying, this worker should get more than that one.
To reward people who have spent time in school to develop their skills more than workers who didn't. If you have a particular need for something, you pay a bonus to a person who, and all of that. But if it is collectively and democratically agreed, then the people who have more wealth don't have to fear that someone's going to take it away because the community as a whole endorses and supports it. If you don't do that, if you allow wealth to accumulate over and against poverty as its other side, then you're going to create, as human history always has, the envy, the bitterness, the jealousy on those who didn't, and the anxiety and the fear on those who did. The ultimate security for wealth, if we're going to allow it to be different, which I think we can, but the only ultimate security is to make that a democratic decision. Because if you don't, you will have endless conflict over redistribution. It would be much wiser to make the distribution from the outset something that is socially agreed. Then you won't have the bitter conflict over redistribution that you're referring to when you talk about right-wingers who are afraid that something will be taken from them.
I see this vicious circle or vicious cycle, I never know which one it is, of like language. Let's say we agree that there needs to be a popular consensus before it can change. And I would argue that, democratizing the workplace, as you so eloquently talk about often, would be a big key, I think, to separating power and wealth. But when you say words like, for example, redistribution, any criticism of capitalism, and then the right is indoctrinated to see that as you want Stalin, Russia, you want, lines for shoes. I know what you mean. You mean that, just a different systematic layout. Like when you're negotiating a contract with partners, it's like, well, I want 10%. I think I'm worth, 20%. Or you're just saying have that kind of conversation as opposed to, one guy getting, billions of dollars. And like you say, everyone else can't afford to send their kid through college. But the word redistribution, I think, is one of those kind of like red flags. So I feel like if you can use a consensus language, then you can help get a popular consensus, and then maybe you can have even right-wing people, because right-wing people also, I think, would like separation of power and wealth. They're always talking about, the dark forces. Anyway, so I'm going to stop yapping, but...
No, I agree with you. And when I speak, I try, for example, to remind people that Gallup and other kinds of polls show an overwhelming majority of the American people having the following interesting views. Number one, they think that the inequality in this country, inequality of wealth, is much less extreme than it actually is. And the second thing that the polls show is even though they estimate the inequality as less than what it is, they feel that inequality is much too big and should be reduced. So it's a kind of a double mistake. They want it reduced, but they don't even realize that it's worse than they already thought it was. So when I go and talk to trade unions or church groups and all of that kind of stuff, I can use language, and I often do, that we're talking here about something that's reasonably fair. Again, let me use my ice cream cone example. I use it because kind of everybody really does know that if you have two children and you go to the park and you're going to buy an ice cream, the kind of reasonable thing to do is to give each one an ice cream, not to give one all of them and the other one not. That offends a notion of fairness, which is lodged in the parents and the children. Part of the reason the child who doesn't get the ice cream is bawling, because that child also shares the notion of what is fair. I think human beings are more than big enough to handle working out systems of unequal distribution that are socially acceptable. We don't have that. And partly we don't have it because in capitalism, you set up such a dichotomy. You mentioned monarchy before. I make a joke often in my speech that we got rid of kings and queens in politics, but we welcome them in economics. Inside an enterprise, the CEO is the king. Unaccountable power. He can change everything about your life because he wants to. And there's precious little you can do about it. In many cases, nothing you can do about it. And so we've allowed situations of unequal power that will guarantee that whatever the distribution is, it will be resented. It will be opposed. It will feel imposed on you because you've had no role in shaping the logic, the values, the system out of which the distribution comes. So yeah, I'm against redistributing wealth. I think it makes for bitterness and hostility, rips societies apart. I think it ought to have a fair distribution to begin with, then we don't have to fight over redistribution.
I can't help but think about, you know, someone like imagining like a Milton Friedman, right. Probably one of your favorites.
Absolutely, yes.
I'm joking, but you know, he might say like, well, what if one kid worked harder for his ice cream and the other kid just sat down and knew he was gonna get one without doing anything? It's kind of, sorry, maybe we should just drop the ice cream thing. Anyway.
No. That's a very good point. Let me respond. That's exactly another example of what a community would have to develop. You'd have to work through with a community of workers. Look, we're all going to share the output. But if one of us is working a lot more to produce that output than another one, for whatever reason, we have to take that into account. Otherwise, we're going to be breeding hostility and bitterness in our community. So maybe what we ought to do, a consensus, is we have to some people who kind of keep track who's doing the work. And if somebody is putting in more hours or working at a faster pace, they get an additional allocation of income. And there'll be people who will object to that, and then it will be discussed and a resolution will be arrived at, which can be opened up for discussion later. But it's a very different thing if you've gone through that process, and you will find much more acceptance of the logic that a collective will come to, why it's important to pay more of, give more of a share of the output to a person who makes more of a commitment or a contribution. I don't think we're dealing with people who have to have get something for nothing and are going to impose that on the community. I don't think so.
I thought I would ask you about almost like in Native Americans, I think, are probably much closer to being in line with
exactly.
You know, how we, you know, are designed and thrived as a species, you know, like a kind of smaller community and closer to how humans lived on Earth for, you know, 50,000 years. And And I think, you know, it makes our bodies and minds thrive naturally, and there is that kind of, it's almost like making a company, like a tribe or something. But
exactly.
So
I agree with that. I've studied the Iroquois, for example, who are famous for the way for hundreds and hundreds, thousands of years, they worked these problems out. And by the way, these arguments are present in Plato and Aristotle too. They understood you allow the kinds of differences in income and wealth, you're going to break your society down. It is not a sustainable arrangement, which is why sooner or later it explodes in revolution, in crime, in all the ways that people protest individually, collectively, because it has become intolerable. I think we're well on the way to doing that in this country, and I know millions of other Americans feel it also. They may not put it in the same words, but they do have a feeling that things are falling apart. If you have a small group of people sitting at the top of every factory, of every office, of every store, then you really can't be surprised if they have that power that they give themselves a disproportionate amount of the output. So they're going to get themselves richer, which they've been doing like there's no tomorrow in our society for the last 50 years. We've allowed them to do that. And we now face all of the social tensions that thousands of years of philosophy have told us are the price you pay if you permit this kind of a system to function this way.
And how would you describe, like if you were to describe like the Iroquois, yeah. How would you describe their economic system, I guess, in our today's terms?
Well, they were very much like what I call worker co-ops. They were very carefully developed notions that every person was a, you know, an individual who was a something to be nurtured. They extended, by the way, the notion of nurturing to the environment. It wasn't just people. It was the animals. It was the river. To make them all equal, it was a kind of respect for everything around you and one another, and that the decisions had to be made collectively. Things that could be done individually were. It was a radically different way, much more democratic in the sense we mean it now than what we have done since. You know, it's complicated. There were ways in which our society is in advance over the Iroquois. Capitalism has things it achieved. No one is denying that. Technical developments in particular have been achieved. Urban society has been achieved by capitalism better or more than other systems. And no one wants to lose those achievements. But along with it came all kinds of things that are no good, that we don't want. You know, the Iroquois were subject to illnesses that we don't have to worry about anymore. That's an achievement we want to preserve, and something the Iroquois didn't capture quite so well. I mean, I'm just fishing for examples here. Learn from the past, but you learn from the past not only what you should do that they did well, but what you shouldn't do. And we want to capture what was good. The Chinese, who are doing much better than the Soviets ever did, they learned some things to do, some things not to do. But they have their problems, which we're going to learn from, and so on, until you kind of get it right. Once they did that with capitalism, it could spread and become the global system. I don't see any reason to expect anything else from the next one.
I've never really heard it described well, or never fully maybe even understood it, to be honest. But how would you describe how China interpreted Marxism, and how has it changed since its beginning to now?
I'd be glad to. China has to be understood around the notion of the leadership there, the Chinese Communist Party. If you know a little bit about China, The Europeans never did to China what they did, for example, to India, or what they did to the Vietnamese area, or any of those other places. Europeans never settled in China. But what the Europeans did do was impose on China tribute that they had to pay. In the year 1900, around then, there was something called the Boxer Rebellion, where the Chinese tried to push the Europeans out, and the Europeans banded together and defeated them militarily and snatched parts of China to make them special zones where the Germans or the British or the French could have a port city and control it. It was constantly these humiliating defeats. Out of that, two things happened. A nationalist movement to kind of rebuild China, to make it not be threatened, to be literally cut apart. That was their great fear, that their culture, the Han people, H-A-N, which is their cultural center of their people, would be carved up into 20 different places, the way the Europeans had carved up Africa, or carved up much of Asia, and so on. So it was a nationalist pull. But the problem was the nationalists wanted to be like the Europeans, but not have the Europeans take over. And there was another group who said, no, 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 the Europeans are not only threatening us nationally, but they're threatening to impose on us a capitalism which is even more unequal. And that was the communists. I mean, they became then the Communist Party. They worked with the nationalists on and off. When the Japanese invaded China in 1931, they worked together, the nationalists. Their leader was this famous guy, Chiang Kai-shek, and the leader of the communists, as we know, Mao Zedong. Anyway, long story short, they take over. The communists fight the Japanese, they develop their army, and when the war is over, the nationalists and the communists fall apart, their alliance disintegrates, and they go to war against each other. The Chinese Civil War, a little bit like the United States. For 4 years, 45 to 49, you have a civil war. The communists won and the nationalists lost. And then the communists come into power. What are they going to do? Well, they're partly inspired by the Marxist tradition. Many of the leaders of the Chinese Communist Party had gone to Europe for their educations because there weren't developed universities in China. So many of them went to Germany or France or England. And they came back with the Marxism that they had absorbed in those Western countries. That's the irony of this. Much of what they did came out of Western Marxism. And the other part of what they did was logical. They copied the one country in 1945, 46, 47 that existed as a model, had existed for two or three decades, and that was the Soviet Union. So they tried to do it that way. They quickly discovered that that model didn't work. So within a decade, from 49 when they become the leaders to 1960, 11 years later, they have their falling out with Russia. And they realize that whatever the model had to offer them, there were bad things about what had happened in Russia they didn't want. And there were things that didn't fit the Chinese culture, which is very different from the Russian culture. So they broke with Russia, very bitter, very, very bitter split. Never been repaired ever since. The split explodes in 1960, and they begin to search for their own way. When it didn't work with Russia, they broke with Russia. When those communes did not work for them, they put that aside. And then they made a decision in the 1970s, which became official in the 1980s, that we have to understand that if we're going to take care of people and not reproduce capitalism, we're gonna have to make a compromise. We're going to have to allow two things that we didn't want. Number one, we have to engage with the world economy. Otherwise, China, which was a very poor country with more people than any other country on earth, let's remember, it has four times the population of the United States right now and always has. So we have to engage the world. We cannot overcome our poverty unless we do. And number two, we have to allow capitalism inside our country under control of the communists in power, but we have to let that kind of economics go because it'll help us connect to the rest of the world, which we have to do, and it'll give us a chance to grow wealthy. When we're big enough and wealthy enough, then we can put aside the capitalism and go back and build our socialism. By the way, they did that. They did all of that. They allowed their own people to become private capitalists. They welcomed European, American companies to set up there. General Motors sells more cars in China today than it sells in the United States, and they are not at all unusual in this kind of reality. When they did that, they gambled. We're going to use those capitalists to build an industry that will produce for the whole world, and we will reap the benefits. They've done exactly that. That's why our clothing is from China. Our appliances are from China. Within the next few years, the automobiles will be from China, et cetera, et cetera. But you know what the model of the Chinese is? And this will surprise folks. The model of the Chinese is the United States of America. But we shouldn't be so quick to misunderstand what's happening in China. They're using capitalism in the hope that they can get the benefit and then push that capitalism aside, just the way the United States' capitalists eventually overcame slavery. It's really a replay of what the United States did. And the idea was, we'll become wealthy on cotton and slavery, and eventually we'll break. Well, when eventually came, we call that the American Civil War. And that's how they finally solved the problem, because the slave people weren't willing to walk away quietly. They weren't willing to go at all. And a war had to be fought. I don't know if the Chinese will eventually be in such a situation. And you can understand the Chinese say it was rough, the Civil War was awful, but it gave the United States a chance to have the subsequent century from 1865 to 1965 be this upward rise on capitalism's soaring in the United States.
You're just saying that they're accepting capitalism, which is sinful to them, the same way Americans accepted slavery.
Just to give you an example, and to understand China a little bit better, over the last quarter century, 25 years, if you compare what has happened to real wages, average real wages in China, and by real wage, we simply mean the wage you get adjusted for the prices you have to pay. Because obviously, if your wage goes up 10% and all the prices you pay go up 10%, you're not ahead. Your wage hasn't gone up in real terms. So if you make that adjustment, which economists do all the time, then the real wage in China over the last 25 years has quadrupled. It's four times greater now than it was then. An average Chinese worker and his or her family can buy four times the quantity of goods and services now that they could then. Over the same 25-year period, the average real wage of the United States has gone nowhere. It's flat. This is the starkest difference that the two societies could have. Now, the Chinese still earn less than Americans, absolutely, a lot less, because they were coming from extreme poverty. However, if you want to understand why the mass of people in China find their system working well, I just gave you the reason. They have their criticisms. They have things they don't like, and they grouse against their government, and they're angry about this and that, for sure. But their basic economic situation has improved in a way they've rarely seen in the last 500 years of Chinese history. If a person doesn't understand that, they're going to misunderstand all the news of the day. One of the reasons we're having the kinds of conflict we do, whether it's The fact that we have 4% of the world's population and 20% of the world's COVID deaths, or that we can't control our police from shooting African Americans every day. I mean, wherever you turn, our society is in a kind of turmoil that is contributed to by the fact that our wages have been stagnant. The only way most Americans enjoy higher consumption today than they did 25 years ago, and many do, is because they've gone into debt on a level that no working class in the history of the world has ever done before. Mortgage debt, automobile debt, credit card debt, and college student debt. I mean, what else are we going to borrow on? It's crazy. And we live in a society whose craziness is shaping our everyday lives. The Chinese are just in a different situation. It may hurt Americans' feelings, but they think of themselves as on the way up, the way the United States was after the Civil War. And we are on the way down. That's why all the aggressiveness of Mr. Trump, which is now repeated by Mr. Biden, poking them and, you know, coming up with tariffs to hit them with, or a trade war to hit them with, or the Biden administration deciding to get really concerned about the Uyghur minority, the Muslims in one corner of China. These are provocations. Let's remember, the United States is coming off 20 years of war against two Muslim countries, Iraq and Afghanistan. We're not in a really good position to be concerned about the oppression of Muslims. I feel for those Muslims, but I feel for all of them. And you have to understand why this is happening. The United States is slipping and is looking for a scapegoat. The Chinese aren't. The Chinese are on the rise. The elevator's going up. This is going to shape our lives in the years to come.
Credit or debt. I wanted to just talk about the philosophy of that for a second.
Good.
You know, mysterious and philosophical and or just an interesting concept. Could you say that America legalized loan sharking in the 20s? Or, I mean, like,
yes.
How does it become such a, is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing?
Decade after decade, from even before the Civil War until around 1970, every decade, the real wages of American workers went up. It was amazing. It's one of the reasons America drew all those immigrants, because they would come and they would write back home to wherever they came from. Gee, I got a job and I have my own house and I have this and I have that. And so more immigrants came because they couldn't do that in the country where they were, and they came to the United States in record numbers. We are a country of immigrants. Wages rose and wages rose. And Americans got this wonderful idea. We live in a charmed country. God must love us better than he likes other folks, because look at what, and no other country had that. And America became this sort of starry-eyed, self-congratulatory American exceptionalism, and we could all expect to realize the American dream. Our own house, our own car, a vacation, a kid in college, all of these wonderful things were somehow going to come to you because they had been coming to people like us for generations. Okay. Suddenly, in the 1970s, it stops. Real wages don't go up anymore. And there's simple reason, two reasons. One, the computer. You can replace millions of people with a machine. Instead of having 100 people work in the monster supermarket, figuring out what's need to be restocked and keeping track of inventory, you have a computer, a checkout, a barcode, and now a machine does what you used to have 100 people do. Okay, and the second thing, American companies decided they could make more profits by going to countries like China, where the wages are much lower. Between the jobs that left and the jobs that were replaced by machines, the demand for workers fell down, and there were too many looking for work, and the wages stopped rising because the employer didn't have to pay rising wages. Okay, now how do you solve the problem if you have millions upon millions of Americans committed to the American dream, having promised their wives and husbands, their children, that they would live better than the parents who had been promised that by their parents and their parents for generations? The only way the American working class could cope with the end of rising wages, especially because there was no conversation in the United States about it. No political leader, no religious leader, no leader at all said, okay, folks, it's a new world. The real wages that we've had rising for 150 years aren't going anywhere. And we have to just talk about what are we going to do in this situation. No one did that. So what the American worker did, two things in the 1970s. He had to, or she had to, cope. No more rising wage, but still the advertisers telling you, you're not a real successful American if you're not participating in the American dream. Two things they did. Number one, if you had one job, you got a second one. If you had a full-time job, you added a part-time job. If you were a homemaker, a woman at home, you went out and got a job. Everybody went out, and the family as a unit began to crumble. And the second thing Americans did, also a personal private adjustment, was to borrow money, because there's no other way you could get the American dream. Your wages weren't going up no more. So you had to borrow it and you had to work more hours, or else you wouldn't get that car or that apartment or those outfits or any of it. And so what we had was a tremendous demand. And the banks of America realized, oh, can we make money now? Because we can lend to the people that are now going to be borrowing without end, as we did from the 1970s until the crash of 2008. The debt of America went wild, crazy. First on the credit card and the car loan, and then now the more recent one, the college student loan. Just an explosion of consumer debt matched by incredible money made by the banks. And here comes the punchline. Where did the money ultimately come from to lend to the workers? The answer is the employer. Because since the 1970s, the employers have paid the same real wage to their workers. But those workers have continued to become more productive. They work more hours, they work harder, they have more machinery, they have computers. This is a recipe for profits going mad, which the 80s and 90s and first decade of this century, that's what they were. That's why we've had a stock market boom. All that money made by the employer, because he didn't have to raise wages, that employer turned around, put it in the bank, which lent it to the worker. The employers lent the American working class the money they no longer had to pay them in rising wages. When you pay a worker wages, you kiss your money goodbye. When you give that worker a loan instead of a higher wage, he owes you that money, has to pay it back, and to boot, has to give you interest while you wait for it to be paid back. For a corporation, it's a no-brainer. It was wonderful. Now we get profit from employing the worker plus interest from lending him money. And that's why more and more Americans, even if they don't understand the details, they don't like capitalism anymore. They have a gut feeling, I'm getting ripped off. And as a professional economist, I'm here to validate that gut feeling. That's exactly what's happening to you. And that's why you need system change. In a democratic society, the majority should be able to do something when they're hurt in the interest of a minority. A government that represented the majority would have been able to make that happen, but we don't have that. We have a government that's responsible, as you and I both know, to the folks who donate to the campaigns and who donate to the party and whose CEOs become the top officials of our government in that famous revolving door that we see all the time. In the last year of this pandemic, while 60 million Americans, more than a third of the labor force, had to be unemployed at least for a while over the last 12 months, 60 million. During that same time, the 650 billionaires in the United States accumulated almost a total of $1 trillion more wealth. You cannot sustain that. That's the wealthy being able, in a period of decline, to grab hold. I understand the instinct, but it brings the crash of this system closer. But now let's get to the next part, the last part. During this time, the capitalists not only were able to profit like crazy, as if that weren't enough, they now decided with their newfound wealth, this goes back to your very first question, to wield power, to use that wealth to protect it by buying the political system. And the way they did that was to say to the politicians, don't you tax us. Well, now you got the same problem. If the government is called upon to fight wars around the world, to provide the roads and the bridges, then where the hell are they going to get the money from? There's only two ways for the government in our society to get the money to do what governments do. It either taxes or it borrows. 2017 was a year when you could make a good argument that never have corporations and the rich needed a tax cut less. But they got one, and a big one. And if you cut the taxes of corporations and the rich the way Mr. Trump did, let's remember, the corporate profits tax was 35% when Mr. Trump became president. And his tax cut in 2017 dropped it to 21%, from 35 to 21. Unbelievable cut. If the government wants to spend money, but it cuts taxes, then the only way it can continue to spend money is by borrowing it. But here comes the punchline. Who do they borrow from? They can't borrow from the mass of the working class because they don't have any money to lend to the government. The major place they go is to corporations and the rich, because they're the ones who have it. That's who lends to the United States Treasury. And what is the money that they lend? It's the money that they don't have to pay in taxes anymore because of the tax cut. Look at it from the point of view of a corporate CEO. Before the tax cut of 2017, I had to give the government several billions of dollars a year in taxes. I kiss my money goodbye, I pay my tax, and the government has it. Now, after the tax cut, he doesn't have to give the government the taxes. He holds on to it. But the day afterwards, the government comes to him and says, we're desperate, we have to borrow. Would you be so kind as to lend us the several billions you don't have to give us in taxes? Oh, says the CEO, you mean instead of giving you the government a tax, goodbye, it's gone, I get to give you a loan of the same amount, which you will pay back to me in 10 years, plus interest every year while I wait. That's called a no-brainer. That's when you go out and have even more champagne at the yacht club than you had last week. That's what the deficit is. And if your own rich people and corporations aren't enough, they don't have enough money because you're borrowing so much, you turn to the rest of the world and say, anybody out there willing to lend me? Sure. And one of the biggest lenders, the United States, by the way, is the biggest debtor country in the world. We've been pulling this stunt like nobody else. No country comes close to the United States in the level of debt we owe the rest of the world. And until recently, it's changed very recently, but until recently, for most of the last 20 years, the single largest creditor, lender to the United States among countries is the People's Republic of China. And here's a little side note for folks to understand. This craziness, this way of dealing with your economic problems that keep profiting the same minority of rich people at the expense of everybody else, if we owe, as we do, more than $1 trillion to the People's Republic of China, remember, you got to pay interest on your loans, which means every year the United States government collects from you and me and everybody else taxes. And the United States government just acts as a forwarding agency. They take billions and billions of our taxes and they deliver it to the Communist Party of the People's Republic of China. Smile. You should smile, because the alternative is you might start crying. And if you didn't know this, which most Americans, of course, don't, it's because our media make a really clear point of not emphasizing this, even though there's nothing secret in what I've told you, nothing you can't verify if you spend 15 minutes with government statistics. Everybody in the world knows, except the American people.
Wow. That's amazing. They should just call it on your taxes, like Chinese Communist Tax.
That's right. You know, I mean, it's just, by the way, they're now number two. They were number one as a creditor. They've slipped to number two. Japan is number one.
The unions, I think, as much as they're, you know, important and positive, is there a way to kind of maybe ensure that they don't become so kind of individually powerful? How do you make it so it's like a happy coexistence where there's, you know, entrepreneurship and motivation protected, but also, you know, anyway, you get what I'm saying.
Yes. This is an area where sometimes I can reach a kind of common ground, at least to a certain extent, with libertarians and conservatives and folks like that. The whole idea of a worker co-op is to give everybody in the workplace a piece of the action, an incentive. You know, if you're a worker and the bathroom light is on your way out of the workplace at the end of the day, you don't care about it. But if you're a part owner, you make sure to flick that light off because you understand your own benefits are wrapped up in everybody behaving like that. I want all the workers to be democratically committed. Ultimately, the best thing for the workers would not to be in an adversarial relationship with an employer. And that can be achieved if the workers, with or without a union, become their own employer. Then they'll have to take into account all the issues an employer used to have to worry about. Only it'll be the workers themselves, skin in the game, a commitment. Give them a real stake, not a share of stock. That's a very distant relationship, but an everyday, concrete, right here and now, ability to run it. I think what that'll do is achieve everything that unions set out to do, but no longer that adversarial tension between the union and the employer, which puts the worker who doesn't like the union but knows that the employer is not his friend either in a kind of difficult in-between situation, allows the employer to play the worker who's in the union off against the one who isn't, and all of the things we're used to. That has got to go. We should never have allowed, as a democratic nation, our workplaces to be exempt from the democratic values we claim to hold so dear.
Is it possible that the problem is actually just the size of societies? Because, I mean, even if you go, you know, even, you know, the Americas before, you know, Europeans came, you know, you have the Aztecs or whatever. Once you have these mega cities, then you have this kind of like weird ultra violence, and you see all kinds of civilizations that seem to have just disappeared, possibly, and they were like city civilizations, possibly. Is the challenge potentially to create like communal identity and behavior on like these mega society scales?
I think the jury is out on that. In other words, I understand what you're saying. There are examples in which small communities were able to have this kind of collective, but I'm not convinced that we can't, as human beings in a creative way, scale that up, make cities be collections of neighborhoods and regions. Many of the most fascinating cities are that. They are big collections, but that you can work your way down to this neighborhood or this block or this set of streets which have an identity, which have a feeling for one another, which do things collectively as a small group to keep those kinds of values alive. I certainly think it's worth trying. I think there are benefits to city life, to urban, to bringing people together that I would hate to see lost. So I think we can do that. And I think that it's certainly worth a try to capture the benefits of democracy that you can get in a small group and see what creative ways we have of translating and building that into large cities to capture the benefits that they offer.
So there is an insane, convoluted cycle of lending going on, basically. And
that's right. Layer after layer of lending.
I'm always confused about debt to other countries because, for example, like some countries, you know, would impose like, you know, arguably very unfair debts, or even between Russia, I mean, sorry, between America and Chinese, there's like all this tension and posturing of the leaders.
Right.
What prevents countries from just saying like, you know what, I don't want to pay, I'm not going to pay you?
Well, you know, nothing. The bottom line is nothing. The United States has, you know, we spend more on military than the next eight countries combined, Russia, China, and the other six who are allies of the United States. So we are the dominant military power in the world. Nobody comes close.
Is that why we're okay with lending so much? Because no one can bully us?
No, we mostly lend because all of the other options of solving our problems are politically unfeasible. You can't do it. Any leader of the Republican or Democratic Party who said, I don't want to put the United States in debt, so I'm going to raise taxes as the alternative way to get the money, would see his presidency come to an end pretty damn quick. He dare not. Look at what Mr. Biden is doing. He can't get it done. He can't get the political muscle, and he's not willing to go out and roust up the mass of people in anger because that'll terrify the business community even more. So he's stuck. The way our system works, he can't. The Republicans don't want to, and he can't do it. So that's why we borrow the way we do. And we're, by the way, borrowing now at a higher rate than ever in American history. So everything I've described to you is becoming more serious, more of a problem than it was up until now. This is a story that does not end well.
So House of Cards, not going to end well. If you had a magic wand, what would you do?
Well, you know, you're familiar a little bit with my work. For me, I think the level of breakdown and the level of inequality and instability and all the rest have a root that has to be dealt with so that another law, another regulation, voting for this one or that one, all of those are too little and they're too late, and that you need a more basic change. And for me, that basic change, it's a demand for the democratization of the enterprise. Has to do with how we organize the factories, the offices, the stores, the things we call workplaces or enterprises, where the goods and services we depend on are produced. That's the core of our economy. We have power in the communities where we live. We can vote the politicians in and out. There's no accountability. And therefore, we cannot be surprised if the minority at the top make decisions that are best for them. So they take the lion's share of the profits. Everybody who works there contributes to whatever profits the enterprise makes. But who decides what happens to the profits everybody helped to create? That's decided by that tiny minority. So they give a chunk to the shareholders as dividends, and they give a chunk to the CEO as some spectacular pay package, and they invest abroad, and they automate their production lines, you name it. They do whatever they want with it. And for me, therein lies the biggest single problem. If you want an economy that works for all the people, the only way to do that is to convert these enterprises into collections of people that operate democratically by law, just like our residential communities do. You have leaders, they are accountable to you.
And if you're who votes, the public or just the people who work at the company?
I think the way we would work it most likely is the people who work in the company make the decisions for the company, but because what the company does affects the community and vice versa, there has to be some co-respectivity there. In other words, the decisions of the enterprise should have input from community members and vice versa, because their decisions affect each other. That's what democracy means.
Like branches of the government almost.
That's right. Checks and balances, like we divide the judiciary from the legislative, from the executive. We would now do something like that in terms of the community and the enterprises in that community. They have to have veto power, if you like, over one another, the way we do in checks and balances. And by the way, there's nothing new about this. You know, the United States keeps telling the world we're in favor of democracy. Well, that's very bizarre. If you believe in democracy, explain to me why, from the beginning of the United States, we never required democracy at the workplace. And then we're surprised that it doesn't work all that well at the residential area either. Well, that's because people aren't used to it. If you let people democratically control their workplace, you can be damn sure they'd be a lot more into it doing it where they live than they are now. The workplace is a lesson in no democracy at all.
Mm-hmm.